like to continue the discussion of the fractional quantum Pauli effect, which is, I think, a necessary basis for discussing topological quantum computing. I won't get as far in this lecture as the interesting case, which, as many of you will know, is the so-called numerical spun holes case. But there's quite a lot of material which is relevant already in the Laughlin and other non-exotic quantum field studies. If I have time, at the end of this lecture, I'll just start on the discussion of the general program, as it were, on the topic of the computer. I'm not sure we have time before that. The first one, I think we can just to recap what we did at the end of the last lecture. The fractional quantum Pauli effect occurs when the number of electrons per flux quantum is some rational fraction. And generally speaking, those rational fractions have odd denominators. There's one exception, which we want to. And I think it's generally agreed that it's impossible to explain the fractional quantum Pauli effect on any non-interacting electron model, because however you arrange them, the electron, chemical potential is always going to lie in extended, band extended levels. And therefore there's no way that you're going to get the longitudinal conductance equal to zero. So, Lockheed's approach, as I'll just recap briefly, was to consider only the states of the lowest layer dilemma, which should be approximately valid, provided that the typical value of the Coulomb interaction is small compared to the cyclotron energy, because remember, it is the cyclotron energy which splits different Landau levels off of one another. If you go to a sufficiently high field, it turns out that the for given values of mu, the cyclotron energy stays as the magnetic field itself. The Coulomb energy, for given filling, will scale as a square root. So if I get a high enough magnetic field, then that means that my cyclotron energy should be large compared to the typical Coulomb energy. So it's reasonable to consider, when you're considering the fractional quantum Pauli effect, to consider only the states of the lowest layer. And a possible choice of the simplified quantum states is of this form here. This is essentially what we wrote down earlier, but it's just a slightly different language. Z here is x plus r y, that takes the load. So we're going to try to out of these states at the lowest Landau level, a particular membrane ground state. And this is what is Ansatz for it. We have the standard exponential factor, which, crudely speaking, you have to put that into any many-body wave function so as to get the new characteristics from the product. But this is the interesting bit here. We have a wave function that goes as zi minus zj to the cubed power, where q is the odd integer. And it turns out that this odd integer is not odd. You have to ensure that the maximum power of any zj occurring in this is the maximum value that you're allowed to have here, which is this. That then guarantees you that the q which occurs here is simply the inverse of the fraction. Okay, so far we basically solved that last time. Okay, let's go on. Now, once you're getting the Laughlin wave function, then qualitatively speaking, at least there's some handwork here, the arguments go through roughly as they do for the integral quantum Pauli effect. For example, if we just go back to the original Lockean argument about taking the Corbino disk, increasing the magnetic flux adiabatically, the unrepublic flux through that disk, and sort of watching how the single particle damage is pushed outwards, the argument goes through in essentially the same way. The only difference is that now you've only got one electron for every three Landau levels. You have one electron for every three flux quanta, and therefore one for every three levels. So you'd expect that the system will only return to its original ground state when you've gone through Q flux quanta. And so that then, following through the same argument as in the integral case, that would then give you a quantum Hall conductance, which in, is proportional to, which is mu, E squared over H. Again, the Thales topological argument is a little more complicated in this case. Thales does not himself apply to something wisely. You have to make a non-trivial assumption, namely that the this double integral, which can be 4 pi squared times an integer, you have to assume that integer is in fact q, it was a new. Given that, the argument goes through. But say it's not entirely true to get it right. Now, the perhaps the most interesting property of the Lockean state is the nature of the quasar particles which occur to it. So let's consider a standard Lockean state, let us say, for example, nu equals a third, Duke 2 plus 1. Imagine that we, we know that if we were to introduce Q, extra flux quanta, and then compensate with one extra electron, that would really not change the situation. Still get the same value as nu. The question arises, what happens if you try to add one extra flux quantum? The maximum value of L, which you formerly had, was M times, sorry, this should be N times Q, not this type of N times Q, and now it should be N times Q plus 1. That requires one extra power of z in the wave function. And so Lockean's answer for the quasar particle studies was this expression here. So you take the original Lockean ground state wave function and multiply it by this factor here. More generally, no particular reason to make the origin special here, you multiply it by this factor product of all the electrons at zi minus z0. This guarantees that the wave function vanishes now at, as it were, the absolute position z0. Not just it always vanishes when the two electrons get close together, but now we're saying it also vanishes at this absolute position z0, which is somewhere in this solid disk here. So in other words, what we've done is to produce a hole at z0. The absence of electrons. So, the question is, what is the charge of this, this hole? Well, there are several ways of trying to derive this. It is possible, not particularly elegant, but it is possible to do a brute force calculation by simply evaluating the expectation value of the integral of the density circle around the position z0. First, when there was no hole there, and second, when we've got this extra factor corresponding to a hole there. And you can see, because you've multiplied by this extra factor here, you can see that the density is going to be reduced in the neighborhood of the hole. The question is how much. That's one way of doing it, and you do find that the effective charge of the hole, the difference between those expressions, is a third of the electron charge. Again, you can do a calculation which you carry carrying your ball, your quasar ball, around the flux quantum. It turns out the Hohmann and Bohmann factor you get corresponds to 1/3 of that degree. And finally, I think it's probably the simplest derivation of that in one's good algebra. Let's consider the creation of three quasar holes at the same point. We'll do that by increasing the magnetic field, so we add three extra flux quantum. We then find that the wave function of the Q holes at the same point is given by this, which is read this as a Q up here. Now introduce an electron and assign it a wave function corresponding to B at the position of the hole. Now we're going to create an n plus 1 electron wave function by integrating over z0. That gives us this expression here. It's a little bit of algebra. It comes out to be this. And now you see we've got a product now from I equals 1, not to n, but to n plus 1. So this is simply the Lockean ground state wave function at n plus 1 electrons and q times n plus 1 plus quantum. In other words, we've now recovered the same value of u this way. So what this argument says, truly speaking, is that as indeed we might have guessed intuitively, q quasar poles are indeed cancelled by one electron. So that means that the effective quasar pole charge is minus e over q. Since the 1 over q is just a nu, say that the effective hole charge is actually minus nu, the effective electron, the effective quasar particle charge is going to be plus nu. We didn't say, I didn't tell you explicitly, how we create an extra quasi electron rather than a quasar hole. To do that, it turns out this is a slight technical point. You have to actually replace z by d by dz and z0 by dz0. Anyway, the important point is that whichever argument you use, it looks as if the effective charge on this this excitation that you've created, this extra quasar hole, is indeed a fraction of the electron charge. That at first sight, that is peculiar, because after all, if you were to cut out a particular area of this disk, an area inside this disk with a very rigid boundary, and actually take a snapshot at any one time of how many electrons are inside, the answer has to be neutral. However, in some sense, the ground state wave function you can regard it as a sort of average, expressing a sort of average over time. And so what's your average over time? Of course, there's no requirement that the number of electrons be neutral. But as I say, you don't have to use this as handwriting argument. You can actually do one of these three calculations. Any questions on that? That's important, but I think that's quite an important point. This next question, maybe more interesting, is what about the statistics of the quasar particles? As we've noticed before, in three dimensions, the fact that you can always contract a two-pi rotation to the identity means that you have to have either further reverse statistics, but we would observe that not a priori necessarily valid in two dimensions. So again, as we did before, let's not consider explicitly the interchange of two particles, but rather let's consider one particle separate. Two interchanges is essentially equivalent to one encirclement. The only difference is you might have to do a translation as well, but that doesn't affect the statistics. The question is, so what happens then if one quasar particle of this type encircles another? Let's suppose that we have a stationary particle. It's actually easier if we do make a hole, because then the expression for wave function comes out into a certain form. So let's put a hole as the origin, and let's put the other hole at some distance out here. And imagine that we adiabatically insert one hole with the other. So the question then is, what is the change in phase of this factor here during this process? Now, of course, if we actually fix the coordinates at zero, then the phase change, delta chi, must just be the number of zeros enclosed by the path, and that has to be unit, as I wrote previously. However, again, we can go through the various phase kind of. Let's imagine that we move this hole around here, and we ask what is the change in the many-body wave function on moving this hole through a small angle theta. Let's just imagine, to help the argument, that the charge inside this contour is concentrated at the origin but fluctuating. Therefore, for any given value of the charge, we'll have delta chi equals n delta theta. However, in fact, the charge inside this region is fluctuating. So when we average over the value of n, then delta chi is going to be the average n times delta theta. And delta chi, the total change around the loop, is given by this expression here, basically just the various phases required. And that comes out to be 2 pi times the average value of n. Now, this really, delta chi only makes sense modulo 2 pi. So modulo 2 pi, that if the average value, now remember, now we're considering a case, we've actually got a hole, a quasi-hole sitting at the origin. So the average number of particles inside your contour is not integral. It has this extra one-third. So the total various phase acquired when I take my second hole around here is simply 2 pi times mu. So in other words, we derive the result, the logical result, that taking one quasar hole around another gives me a very phase of pi mu, for example, pi over 3.
For some reason, this reasoning makes me feel uncomfortable.
Not more fun naturally.
Because it seems to me like if you're changing the number of electrons and you're making a loop or whatever, it's the same as making a loop and bypassing some number of electrons. Or, you know, if you have say 5 electrons,
yes,
and then for half the loop, and then 4 electrons for the other half of the loop, it's the same as saying you have 5 electrons for half your loop, and then come and wind your loop around one of the electrons to exclude it, and you come back around, and then that feels to me like it's the same as having 4 electrons the entire way. Maybe I'm missing something, but I'm not sure.
Well, I think it's maybe helpful to go back to that toy model example I gave in the earlier lecture, where I had a heavy particle which was could commute between two potential worlds, and a light particle which was constrained in a fixed state relative to it. And then I imagined dragging the light particle once around one of the worlds. And the result we found there was that the total barrier phase acquired in that process was essentially the probability that the heavy particle is sitting inside of you.
Okay, yeah.
I don't know if that helps or not. So again, you do have to, when you're talking about statistics of interchange, you do have to define the process you're considering rather carefully. So we are considering this adiabatic, very phase-like exchange on surface. Sorry, I think I said something wrong, so I'm going to go. the delta that's 2 pi nu is the encircle phase. That means the exchange phase is pi nu. That's just a trivial point, but essentially it's twice exchange.
Right, so it's more, it's less to do with, when you use the phrase average, we're more talking about a superposition of cases, in a sense.
Yeah, well, yeah. I mean, exactly. The,
yeah.
The after all, you know, the ground state wave function is just a superposition of probability amplitudes.
Yeah, I think so.
No, this isn't good. So, this, you know, if there are more questions or comments on this, let's just stick here for a moment because it's quite important to see. Now, this is fine. The Lofgren idea, as it stands, is fine as regards the particular quantum, fractional quantum Hall states, which correspond to a filling factor, 1/3 or 1/5 or 1/7, that is simply 1 over some odd integer. However, in real life, we find that quite a lot more than that. So the question is, how do we account for these more complicated non-Lofgren states? Well, some of them we can handle relatively easily. If you think of states like, say, Newton's 2/3 or 4/5, then you can think of those as the particle Hall conjugate of 1/3 and 1/5 respectively. In other words, what you can do is to imagine that you start from a completely filled lowest Landau level. Which, because the ground state, the wave function for that state is completely unique. It has no degeneracy. You fill up everything. And now you imagine that you start simply to take holes out of it and discard the holes by a lot of wave function. So so that would satisfactorily account for these guys. Again, if you've got states like, say, 4/3 or 7/3, then you can assume that one or more of the Landau levels is completely filled. For example, in the case of 4/3, you can assume that your spin up lowest Landau level is completely filled. So that's out of the problem. Now you start filling the lowest Landau level and spin down. And then essentially you get back to the Lofgren picture. However, there is a slight complication because in the higher Landau levels, the radial dependence of your wave functions is different from what is in the lowest one. So you can't use the same analytical formula for the wave function. But the general idea that properties come across. However, that still doesn't tell the whole story. What about states like 2/5 or 1/7? Both of those are by now well established fractional quantum Hall effect states. And there are a couple of ways of approaching this, actually. Historically, the earliest way, in Halper and others, was the so-called hierarchy approach. I think most people nowadays would tend to take the view that a rather simpler approach is the one due to Jane, which came out rather later. And it is called the Kotzler-Ferber approach. And it's important just to take a brief look at this because it will be essential in analysing the interesting case of you with five poles. Incidentally, I should just one thing I should say. I realise it's unsatisfactory that the lectures are not yet available on the web. I'm told that this is being worked on and will happen. Hopefully, it will happen this week. So that, and essentially, if people want copies of the notes, I can easily get them copies. So don't think you've got to necessarily take it down. Okay, the composite Fermi idea goes something like this. A uniform electron, imagine that we have a uniform electron and each electron somehow manages to carry with it a flux alpha, some number alpha, times the flux quantum. Then, in some kind of real field sense, this is equivalent to an external magnetic field, which produces an average flux of alpha phi zero per electron. So imagine that we start with the integral quantum effect, where nu is some integer p. Now imagine that we attach a alpha phi zero flux, alpha phi zero flux to each electron. Then, what's this going to do to the exchange of two electrons? Well, now, when one electron encircles another, it's going to see the harmonic bone flux associated with the other one. So, you're going to produce, first of all, the exchange, the ordinary neutral, principal exchange factor minus one. But then you're going to have a harmonic bone effect. Now, and you have to think about this rather carefully. The exchange of two electrons, each of them is going to go halfway around the other. Each of them is going to see the flux alpha on the other. So that gives you a total flux, a total extra phase, a harmonic bone phase of alpha. Well, in general, that screws things up considerably. I mean, it's going to mean that your statistics are quite different from anything that you know above. On the other hand, if alpha is plus or minus 2n, where n is integral, then obviously this has no effect. So, and then we can write that the effective flux, which the electron sees, is the external flux plus or minus twice n times the number of electrons. So an argument, and I think it takes a little getting used to, actually. It's not really clear it's all to work. And in fact, Jane had to work quite hard to demonstrate that it doesn't work.
What are the reasons why it would not be, for me, nothing is immediately clear, but what would be some objections to this reason?
Well, I think primarily the idea that you can replace a flux associated with each electron by an effective external magnetic flux.
Is that because you sort of, in the effective external magnetic flux, you can move the electron sort of with respect to the flux lines, whereas
the flux lines
follow you?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is a the only way really to justify it is to write down an explicit wave function, which Jane did, or just get to that in a moment. Let me just go on with the handwave algorithm for a moment. The effective flux is the real flux plus or minus this. Because you can then, and now let's think of that situation as being the integral quantum effect at this value of the factor. So this then corresponds to a true filling factor of p over 2np plus or minus 1. And indeed, most of the extra factor isn't that you're not simple log of stage 2. Producing this filling factor which can be described as well. As I say, this problem is far too hard. You have to actually try to write down a trial wave function. And Jane's trial wave function is to take the standard integral quantum effect wave function for the given value of p, and then multiply it by zi minus zj to the 2. Interestingly, this is maybe not really obvious. What happens if p equals 1 here? Well, if p equals 1, you have the simply a single field lambda. the wave function for that is well, it's usually written in the form of a product over the basis states which we wrote down. But what's interesting, and not meant to be obvious, what's interesting is that in fact the lowest Landau filled state, which you've got every one of your lowest Landau level states filled, that can be written simply as a product, the usual exponential factor, and a product over zi minus zj. I say that's not obvious, but if you play around with it, you can see that doesn't work. So, given that, you see that all that gives you apart from the exponential factor is just one more factor of zi minus zj. So, so the whole thing comes out as a product, zi minus zj to the 2n plus 1. But m is integral. That is just the Laughlin wave function for that value of m, 2n plus 1. And so, nu equals 2n plus 1.
So just to be clear, the James trial is just the Laughlin wave function with some additives.
The definition of James wave function here is that you take the integral quantum wave function for filling p, that's a general, and then multiply it by the other 60 j to the 2n, y j. Now, for the special case where p equals 1, then the result of doing that is just the Laughlin wave function. So in other words, the Laughlin states are just a special case of the James states. More generally, though, you get all these four elements and some 13 and some whatever.
So, I mean, how should we be thinking about the difference? In, like, the difference is that there's some closer association between the position of the X-flux and the position of the electrons? Is that...
Well, this...
And that it seems like...
I have to say, frankly, I also find it. It's a little difficult to intuit what's going on in this operation. But I think the picture people usually give is that the electron is actually dragging actually 2n quantum flux around with it.
Is there any physical reason for why that might be the case, or is that just...
Well, as I say, it's... Some people, including obviously Jack, find it helpful to visualise the electron as actually having this extra two flux quanta attached to it. Like, so I personally don't find it terribly helpful to do that. I think the best justification I can really give is that it does seem to explain in a rather natural way why one should get this kind of value of u. And moreover, you can actually try to do numerical computations for small numbers of electrons. And try to actually get the ground state wave function for these filling factors numerically, and then compare it to the university. But I would have to agree, not on something on Fox, on YouTube. Unfortunately, we need to at least know this language, because this is the language in which a lot of the work on U equals 5 holds, on the state is going to be expressed. Okay. Let's go on to the... some of the experimental evidence for some of these phenomena. I think I'd say right away that the question of the experimental evidence for both fractional charge and even more for fractional statistics is in some sense a very emerging one. The trouble is that we've got a sort of overall conceptual pattern for describing the fractional quantum Hall effect, and you don't really know, as it were, which of the pieces of this pattern are independent of one another. And so it's not at all obvious whether a particular kind of experiment is evidence simply for the whole pattern. When you can take out particular pieces and say, well, this shows definitively that you, for example, have fractional charge or have fractional statistics, or whatever. I think that point will become a little clearer after I've gone through some of the more experimental evidence. One of the very early attempts to verify the existence of fractional charge was the periodicity of transport through a so-called quantum antidot, a dot which can get accumulated or falls on it. So you basically made a constriction in your quantum sample, you put a dot in there, and you're trying to, different philosophies, you're trying to track, or you think you're trying to track quasar particles or quasar holes on the antidot. And because this is this constriction is non-infinite width, you can indeed get transport through it, and you might believe that the transport would be affected by the charge on the antidot. So what people did, a couple of experiments which did this in five days, they measured the dependence of the quaternion resistance on the magnetic field and on the back gate voltage, which controls. You have a back gate which can actually control the number of electrons on the amount of charge, as I think last year, on the antidot. And what turns out is that the results are consistent with it. A periodicity of your measured resistance, which is a periodic in field with a period corresponding to the flux quantum on the dot. It's periodic in the backgate voltage with a period, and this is an interesting one, with a periodicity corresponding to an effective charge with over 3. Now, is that evidence for fractional charge? Gordon and Sue, who did one of the first experiments, claimed it was. Franklin et al., the Cambridge group, did a very similar experiment, but did not interpret it in this way. They said, no, this is really not evidence for fractional charge as such. It's only evidence for the average number of electrons per available state. In other words, simply telling you that the number of electrons per flux quantum is equal to nu. And they had a sort of hand-wavy argument on this, which is a version of a slightly more sophisticated argument I'll give later. The situation returns to itself when we change the flux through the antidot by 3 phi 0 and add one extra electron. Curiosity in the electron number is a third of the periodicity of the flux. However, the periodicity of the flux is 1. Therefore, the periodicity of the average number of electrons is a third. In other words, Franklin probably said, this system simply rearranges itself every time the average number of electrons changes by a third. And that gives you the appropriate periodicity.
Isn't the superparticle antiparticle it only makes sense to talk about it in the context of having flux going through the material in the first place, right?
Yeah.
So, is there any sense in which these two interpretations are equivalent, in the sense that saying one thing is in the sense saying the other?
I think they, they are equivalent, yes.
Right, because it doesn't mean anything to say this superparticle has fractional charge, that also saying something about the
relationship. For this experiment, I think I would agree. For this experiment at least, I think I would agree with that. Yes. We can go on perhaps to a slightly different experiment, which in some sense I think some more convincing idea of fractional charge, but again, maybe not totally convincing. That's Shotton's experiment. The standard textbook result for Shotton is a point of contact between standard textbook metals with no bottom port vector like that, which is essentially valid in the limit where the transmission probability is through the contact is small, and simply says that the Shotton noise is simply twice the electron charge times the total current. Very simple and straightforward formula. Now, it would not, I think, be a terribly good idea to simply try to check that result, because you basically have a single number here, and that doesn't give you a lot of flexibility in terms of noise. However, luckily, one can actually write down a finite temperature generalization of the standard expression. You see, a rather complicated expression. The interesting thing is that the electron charge comes in several different points. If you stare at that expression, you see that in general it doesn't reduce quite to this for temperature goes to zero. But if you allow the transmission probability to actually the contact go to zero, then it does. So everything is consistent. So the interesting question is, what about the noise across a quantum Hall sample in the fractional quantum Hall machine? First of all, what does the theory say? Well, in fact, the theory does say that you would expect to get a formula here with E replaced by E star. However, the theory behind that is not non-trivial at all. You've got to actually consider to get this result, done by Kane and Fisher, to get that result, you actually do have to consider explicitly the edge states, which is something I haven't got into. However, result seems to be for edge correction. The experiment basically looks at the, again, a sort of four-terminal setup here, where you're measuring, you're essentially measuring the longitudinal resistance here, because you're measuring the voltage that's in these two terminals, the current between these two. So the right voltage and current paths don't cross. So that's the longitudinal resistance. And indeed, they do find that finite temperature, they get a formula which looks pretty well with this, provided you replace E by E star. Again, question, everything is consistent with having this fractional charge. In what sense have you improved this? Or in what sense are you, in some sense, just again re-expressing the fact that you cause a third? Stop for a moment. Those were the main classes of experiments which claim to show evidence for fractional charge. And at least, I think at least the interpretation of the Shotton noise experiments in terms of this formula, that does look reasonably unambiguous. But again, so what? What exactly is it to tell you? Not so clear. When we go on to fractional statistics, unless life becomes even more worse. The first group to claim evidence for fractional statistics was this group, or again, a problem group at St. Stanley. the theory of this one is actually quite complicated. I won't try to explain all of it in detail. Basically, they measured, again, a full terminal resistance. The voltage probes are here and here, current probes are here and here. So basically, again, this is, since the current and voltage probes don't cross, this is a longitudinal resistance. And in this geometry, now, an interesting point about this is that you actually have here not one but two different quantum Hall states. That's one of the points which makes this experiment more complicated to interpret. In the absence of the constriction here, you get this prediction for the longitudinal resistance, and that seems to be similar. However, you now put in this constriction, you put a dot in here, and you ask how does the what dependence does this longitudinal resistance see as a function of the back gate voltage, and also a function of the flux on the dot. So it's again very similar to the experiment which needs to show fractional charge. But the principal result here is that the resistance is periodic as a function of flux. With a period now, you'll get phi 5 times phi 0. That's interesting because, you see, this really is new equals 2/5. One thing I think I didn't stop on, and perhaps should just go back to when discussing this, is what is the, on these Jane states, the non-Lofted Jane states, like 2/5, what is the effective charge on a quasar particle? And the answer is, let's go back to that for a moment. Here we go. In fact, the effective charge in Jane theory on a quasar particle is E over 2 mp plus or minus 1. So for example, if you're new, your value of mu is 2/5, it's not, the charge is not 2/5, but 1/5. It's the denominator expression. Again, not perhaps entirely obvious. Anyway, they did fine, again. They found a flux periodicity with a period of 5 phi 0, and a charge periodicity with twice. So the ratio delta q divided by delta phi is in fact just the new 2/5. Same experiment on the same general lines. In this case, I know what mu equals a third of the rest, so we're not in the state of Uber. The blue area is actually a dot, so it attracts electrons. Again, you know, it's going to be resistance. The periodicity, the longitudinal resistance is periodic. It's a function of flux. We've got a period of phi 0. And it's periodic in the back voltage where a period corresponding to E3. So what do we make of this? Not at all clear, in fact, I think. But what Dorman and Company interpreted in the something like this. Let's consider the second experiment. The case of mu equals a third quantum ball fluid with a central dot. That's just a convenience. They actually had an antidot, but it's a second dot. So experimentally, the flux periodicity is phi 0, and the charge periodicity is E over 3. So a change by phi 0 in flux corresponds to a change E over 3 in average charge. Okay, suppose now we require that the wave function of charge at minus third plays our particle in circling the dot returns to its original value every phi 0 without any extra phase factor. I just give you the problem that comes in here. The total phase factor then is the Bohm phase factor plus the Berry phase factor. We know that the Bohm phase factor is E star times delta phi over H1, which is 2 pi over 3. And therefore, they claim the Berry phase factor is minus 2 pi over 3, just divided by 2 pi total. So the claim is that the exchange phase for one reactor two, which is half of the encirclement phase, is pi over three. That argument, I think, seems to me and seems to a lot of people really rather shaky in my view. It has a possible interpretation of the data, but it's really not at all obvious that the data is telling all of this. Even if we do accept all of these arguments, including the ones about shotguns and so forth, there's a general problem here. They're all done at temperatures much less than the post-subparticle excitation gap. If they didn't, you wouldn't have a well-defined polymorphic plasma at all, so it's got to be done at zero temperatures. So basically, what are these experiments telling us about? They're either telling us only about the ground state, or at best, about the properties of the zero excitation energy edge quasar particles. Really, they're not telling us anything at all about the bulk quasar particles. So that, I think, already is something rather unsatisfactory about this whole class of experiments. Having reached this point of confusion, let's step back for a moment and try to think about the problem from a rather more general point of view. It's a rather generic problem here. Namely that most of the obvious experiments need only the factor of quantum forward effect, by which I mean the fact that the filling factor is nu, some rational fraction, and you need either that or the Heron-Moen effect for the explanation. Let's get a little following situation. You have a simple ring here with an horizontal bone flux applied through the middle. And suppose we imagine that the ring does contain quasar particles of charge E star, for example, EM3, non-integral electron charge. Well, at first sight, you'd think that since the electron charge has been reduced by a factor of three, then the effective flux quantum would not apply by a factor of three. In other words, you'd expect the periodicity of any phenomenon in this geometry to be three phi zero. Well, that's a problem with that. The problem has to do with gauge invariance. It's very, very old, it deals with bars and gap, way back in sometime in the 60s, I guess. Suppose we have a relative bone vector potential on this ring here. So the bone now has a kinetic energy term, which is given by this expression here, has some single particle term, and it has a two-particle fraction, driven fraction. We have to obtain the correct ground state, or for that matter, to obtain the free energy at point of temperature. We have to solve the time-independent shrink equation for this Hamiltonian, and we must solve it subject to the so-called single value of the power energy. What that means is that if we take a single electron, for a moment given the rest fixed, a single electron, and take it all the way around the ring back to itself, we must recover the wave function, the original wave function, up to possibly an extra 2 pi in the phase. So the extra 2 pi is not visible at all, but we must recover it. This is precisely the argument to give you the usual quantization and the momentum of a single body. Now, let's imagine that we perform a gauge transformation. By doing this, we get rid of the vector potential in our Hamiltonian. So our Hamiltonian does not contain the vector potential. Kinetic energy is just of the straightforward form. However, what we had to change is the single value of the power energy. And we had to multiply this expression here by exponential 2 pi I times the aurora bone flux against the flux quantum. Now, you see, if it happens that phi AB is exactly equal to the integral number of electrons quantum, then that makes no difference. So this factor is then just one, and the magnetic vector potential is formulated from top. More generally, from this argument, you see that all properties have to be periodic in the iron of open flux with a period phi zero. And that's the famous phi zero theory. So, strictly speaking, you can have a periodicity H over E star only if E star is an integral multiple, not if it's a fraction. One example, of course, when E star is a multiple of E is the case of Cooper pairs in the superconductor when N equals 2. But fractional charge will not satisfy this issue. Well, however, it turns out there is a wrong way to do something in this argument. Imagine that we bend the two edges of our Corbino disk around so as to form a dejoin and form a torus. And imagine that we somehow managed to maintain a magnetic field perpendicular to the disk area. That's not physical, but let's assume we do that. Then that would be exactly the problem which we're new to, and which I mentioned in lecture 3. And when you, as you might remember, obtain the exact result, but for the fractional quantum Hall effect, new epsilon q on a torus, there are different ground states which are degenerate and mutually inaccessible within sort of factors of order exponential minus L over psi, where L here is the sample dimension and psi is some kind is effectively magnetic length. Which remember, magnetic length is essentially a microscopic quantity. It's the order of, for one tesla, it's the order of 250 angstroms. So small compared to the size of the disk. So that result is exact, and we can be fairly confident with it. The question is, what implications would you expect this result of random for the torus to have with the Corbino disk geometry? Well, crudely speaking, you'd expect that there are, again, three ground states which are very close to being degenerate with one another. So that the picture looks something like this. You see, we do in fact here have the whole pattern. Forget about the red curves for a moment, just focus on the blue curves. The blue curves are actually the ground state energy, for example, as a function of flux. And you see that we really do have the required by periodicity, that is, everything is periodic in single flux quantum. However, what's going to happen if we actually try to take the system along this route? In other words, we try to increase the flux gradually. Well, everything depends on what happens when we get to this crossover here. In real life, there are going to be small but non-zero terms in your Hamiltonian, which are likely to break the exact degeneracy of these states here. For example, terms involving tunneling of an electron from one side of the disk to the other. Those are going to be exponentially small, and they will be there. So a picture consistent with the Lazaridis theorem goes something like this. For all but the very slowest sweeps, you basically just sweep straight across this crossing here. And then you might do something like that and eventually come back down here. In other words, you've got a periodicity now of 3 phi zero, not a phi zero. However, for the very slowest sweeps, the system will sweep up here and realize that there really is, that there really are terms which have mixed these two states, so you've got a voided crossing here. And if you've got a very slow sweep, so you'll go back down here. And a very slow sweep, you follow the green curve. And you'll get a really phi zero periodicity. So this is a beautiful argument. I think I've referenced it here. It's a good one by Thales and Gay in 1991. Essentially dealing with this result. If you sweep your vol change or your superflux slowly enough, you should not get the 3 phi 0 periodicity, you should get the phi 0 periodicity. In other words, the fractional quantum Hall effect should go over to the integral quantum Hall effect, even under the conditions where mu is fractional. Now, what in real life is going to control the speed at which you swoop along this curve? Well, remember that the thought experiment was that you varied your flux as a function of time to create an EMF voltage. Okay? So the rate of sweep is a portion of the voltage, the period of the sweep is flux quantity divided by the voltage. So this means that in order to see this transition from the fractional quantum Hall effect to the integral effect, you've got to have a voltage which is small enough that this quantity is all at 1. Now this delta E here is something like exponential minus L over xi. So that means that the voltage must be exponentially small. So for any reasonably thick ring, you would not expect this voltage to be so small that you would not be able to measure it in the experiment. That's basically Thales and Gibbs and so forth. Now I'll just go on for a moment and consider the Corbino disk with a constriction, which is fairly close to the geometry of the Schrodinger's experiments. Again, you might expect that you take this kind of trajectory here. But even if the system does try to follow the red curve, there may be some kind of residual interaction with the environment, which may cause it to drop back to the lowest state for that block. That process will be a reverse region, regenerate non-zero voltage and a non-zero backscattered current. And both B and IB will be characterized by some kind of shutouts. So the real $64,000 question in this whole field are these arguments based on the quasi-periodicity alone sufficient to generate the Schrodinger's experiment with E star equals a third? And I'm afraid the answer is I don't know. I think it's an interesting speculation, but the calculation is by no means true. I haven't done it, and I don't know where it's been done in the literature. But if the answer is yes, then really the experiments don't tell us anything about the charge or statistics of even the integrals of particles. What they're really telling us about way back is that indeed mu equals the spectrum of it. Nothing more, nothing less. Okay, I suspect that is very confusing. The problem is that I think the experimental situation is very confusing this time. There are a whole clutch of experiments in the literature, must be dozens of them by now, which claim to produce evidence for fractional charge and/or fractional statistics. Again, it really isn't very clear what they're telling us and what they're not. Let's see if I have time. Okay. I think I should just stop for a moment because I have some more material in this lecture, but it's on something quite a lot different. So perhaps we'll just stop for a moment and try to review what we didn't really understand about the fractional quantum Hall effect. I think the theoretical situation is rather clear. There are these various arguments which are relatively straightforward and relatively strong, which say that the mean charge associated with a Lovelin quasi hole is indeed a fraction of the electron charge. Also, I guess the arguments about the exchange of two quasi-poles is relatively straightforward. So on the theory side, I think things really are relatively clear-cut and doesn't seem to be any major objection. But, as you see, when we get to the experiments, well, so everything is consistent with the idea that you have fractional charge and fractional statistics. Whether you can say that you've actually proved that is, I think, a very murky question indeed. Unfortunately, the trouble is these things may matter when we get to real topological quantum computing, because we're dealing with fractional quantum ball states, which in some sense are even more delicate than the roughly or gem state.
I mean, so there's a sense in which you need to disprove rather than prove that something is the case, right? And so, I mean, if all of our experiments, you know, agree with our predictions, then it's not an effective theory, I suppose. It's like, I mean.
Yeah, that's all. I mean, this is a very, you know, it's a sort of generic question in philosophy of science, I guess.
Yeah, it's a philosophy of science question.
If I had my pure logician's hat on, which I do occasionally put on, then of course I would make the obvious remark, which is sort of true as of the logic of science, that no finite number of experiments can ever prove the theory to be correct. Right?
Yeah.
in the experimental physics literature, continually get a problem situation. Theory 2 has predicted experimental consequence B. Experimentalists have gone away and they detected experimental consequence B. They say, oh, we can now prove that theory 2 is correct. But just from a philological point of view, that's complete nonsense. the name of the logical fallacy. The fact that 2 implies E does not imply that E implies 2. You can't project it.
But is there any way that you can rule out the existence of an alternative theory, say, T5, which would
certainly
be? Absolutely. Yes, that would be. And
Lodge,
that can characterize it.
Sorry?
I mean, a set of all possible alternative theories, how do you characterize it to say that you can rule it all out?
No, of course, that's very difficult. The useful thing to do in this kind of situation is precisely that. That is to define a class of theories which are opposed to, in some sense, to T, which are different from T, and try to do experiments which rule them out. Because at least, here we'll take some obvious qualifications, a finite number of experiments is sufficient to refute. And of course, you're probably thinking here, I suspect, of the Bell's theorem, which is an excellent example of this. Rather than proving that quantum mechanics is right, which no finite number of experiments can do, the people, Friedman, Clauser, and subsequent people, decided to try to refute a class alternative theory, the energetic global theories. Okay, so the question arises, can one define cleanly in this kind of case a class of alternative theories which one could try to prove to be false? I think almost certainly to do, my strong guess is that if you were to do so, this would be equivalent, or nearly equivalent, to the claim that the Laughlin wave function is not even qualitatively correct for the fractional for the simple fractional. That, of course, is a logical possibility. An interesting question is how implausible is that conjecture made by these neuron results? When one says numerical results are results for a particular model. Which may or may not reflect the actual reality of the experimental setup. Generally speaking, these numerical calculations are done for a rather simple model in which you have translation invariance and the plane of your surface. You have a crew of interaction, which is, which may or may not have some kind of rules, but it's one of our multipliers. And you have a uniform magnetic field, etc., etc. Now, okay, within those, within that framework, people have done calculations of the up now to about 20 electrons, and they've claimed to at least find a very good approximation to the exact ground state wave function, and it does look very, very like the bottom wave function. How convincing is that? Well, you might argue that in your life there are all sorts of complications. You have to take into account there are impurities, for example, which in fact play an important role in making the feathers final. So you have to, at some stage, be able to worry about it. It's entirely possible that the crew of interaction is screened in a way which actually depends on the distance, so it's not exactly one of our arm, etc., etc. Generally speaking, I think people tend to shun this kind of complication away, and to believe that on the theoretical side, we really do have very good evidence of the wave functions. So I think if you wanted to make this alternative class T prime of theories, which you're trying to exclude, you would almost certainly have to involve the assumption that nothing is not even qualitative. So that, in some sense, that's the problem. Given that Lofton is at least qualitatively right, does that wave function by itself qualify all the things we have?
It seems like the question is like really people ask. In the experiment that you were showing before, the question we're asking is, do we have fractal charge? Is it reasonable to say this has fractal charge?
Yes.
This is made of the material of fractal charge?
Yes.
It just basically amounts to the question, is this a useful operational assumption? Right.
I think that perhaps is a good way of looking at it, yes. But and rather than argue as it were high matter physics, that does fractional charge exist? Is it going to be a useful concept in interpreting those kinds of experiments?
Right.
It certainly looks in the shock noise as if the answer is yes, at least in that context. Yes. Yeah. So arguing the arguments backwards and forwards between various groups over this for the last 20 or 30 years, maybe your attitude is the right one. To just be a little pragmatic here.
I mean, when we're talking about condensed matter, it seems counterproductive to go into whether there's such a thing as a fundamental fractional charge or whatever, because obviously you're dealing with sort of an effective perspective, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so maybe that's where we should do at least for now.
I mean, I can't say that should help, but should be the thing that you would have done.
I think probably rather than try to start on the rest of the material which I had there, I should have stopped at this point. Because it is a natural break. And the next lecture, I want to try to introduce some rather general considerations about non-abelian anions and how they might be used at topological quantum computing. And as I think most of you had a note from me. An emailed message about possible loop within.
No, I mean,
did you put your name down on the list?
What list?
Oh, that's well. Okay. So I'll probably give you my note. I'll send it. Make sure you get it. Yeah. No, I did actually send you a message with some suggested reading, and in fact, suggested reading will be just right for the next lecture. It's basically it's an introductory material from the famous Das Salma Nayak et al. Review article. I have given incidentally just a few references in the email. This particular, if you want to get seriously into topological quantum computing, this review article by Nayak et al. In Reviews of Modern Physics in the fall of 2008 is a very good starting place, I think. So it's a rather good general overview of the field. But the, and some of it is quite tough going. But the first couple of sections are relatively easy to read, so I would recommend you to have a look at those before the next lecture.
I have a silly question. Yeah. In group theory, I know, for example, what abelian means and non-abelian.
Yes.
But for example, abelian group and non-abelian group. Here, what does it mean if you want to?
Well, physically, it means that you have a imagine you have a certain set of entities, perhaps quasar polygons or something like that, and you can do certain kinds of operations to them. The particular kind of operation I'm most interested in is branding or exchanging. Now the question is, do these operations that you're about to carry out commute with one another or not? And we'll see that, in fact, there's a rather natural way. Most of the physical examples of anyons in the topological quantum computation context that I'm going to be talking about is actually a special class of anyons called Ising anyons. The reason for why they're called Ising is rather elaborate, so I won't try to go into it. But anyway, as turns out, most of the most plausible current candidates for topological computing are Ising anyons. And then it turns out that the exchange interchange of two particles behaves according to the so-called braid group, which we'll talk about. I'll explain it in the next lecture. Now, I should just warn you one thing. We're going to be spending a lot of time on the rest of this course on Ising anyons. Unfortunately, they are not ideal for topological quantum computing. The reason for this is actually more peculiar. To realize any kind of quantum computing effectively, realizing universal quantum computing, you've got to be able to do two kinds of things. You've got to be able to do one single qubit operations, which means that you must be able to take a qubit, which is, let us say, originally pointing up on the block sphere, and put it in any direction whatever on the block sphere. There's a set of one qubit operations. You've got to be able to conduct at least one two qubit operation. The usual one is C naught, but could be C phase or other things, which were in 10 two qubits. Right? Now, it turns out, rather ironically, that in the case of Ising anyons, conducting the two qubit operation, the C naught or whatever, is actually not straightforward. However, the operations are not rich enough to do all the one qubit operations that you want. In other words, you can't get to any arbitrary point on the block sphere. However, interestingly, it turns out that there are certain kinds of rather straightforward protocols. One example being Grover protocol for finding an unknown eigenvalue. Some of these protocols can, in fact, be implemented with Ising anyons, with complete topological protection. I'll give an example of that. It would not be useless to have an Ising quantum computer. It just wouldn't be perfect. For that, we have to go more sophisticated. We have to talk about this. Okay, so let's stop this point there and continue on Thursday. I'll start on a general subject to give a rather general introduction of using a specific yes, if there's anyone else who's not, hasn't been received.